Hey, Internet, got a special treat for you today, and that is Charles Worth. You can see the UL logo on his jacket because we are in front of the UL booth. Of course, you know UL because of 3D Mark. Everybody's run it. Charles here is going to tell us a little bit about some updates that are coming, hopefully this year, from UL that's going to come in the benchmarking scene. What should people be on the lookout for this year from UL?
Currently in development is our new website. We have a new 3D Mark website coming in development and hopefully be released by the end of next month.
Okay.
This is if things go good. We just had a release of a new Procyon product called Radoa, which is our AI inference benchmark. And so we're looking at different AI models, and we're testing the Snapdragon, which is the ARM64 platform, and we're testing Windows. We're testing hopefully Macintosh fairly soon.
Oh, okay. And that'll be Windows consumer. I mean, that'll be
that enterprise.
Okay. Oh, enterprise.
That's an enterprise. But the 3D Mark website is consumer.
Okay. And what kind of changes at least on the website?
In the search engine, we have more knobs and controls for testing or for searching and comparing results.
Okay. And there's anything else? There's something happening also on the Mac side for consumers, right?
We have an upcoming product coming out for the Mac for the Procyon for the enterprise portion, and that'll be comparable hopefully with the Windows products.
Okay.
And that's what the target is.
So you can compare for, I think the Procyon right now is does Office, does Adobe
right,
stuff.
Right, right. It's industry standard applications, and we use Adobe and we use Microsoft.
Okay. So we should be on the lookout for those. And of course, the real reason I'm here to talk to Charles is, if you don't know, Charles is a famous overclocking. He is old school. Like, Charles has been overclocking since before the time of the 300A Celeron.
Right. Well, I started with memory modifications back in the 8080 time, or the 8086, the 4164 memory modules, upgrading to the 4164s, bending pin number 7 out to, stack piggyback memory modules. So I started back a very, very long time ago. And the memory mod was one of the early mods that we did. And then the 300A mod came out, which was the tape mod over one of the pins, and you changed the processor speed from 300 megahertz to 450 megahertz with just a tape mod.
See, that's like when people, a lot of people, like for practical overclockers, they will say like I will say things like, I don't think it's worth it today because, in my day, your day, you go to 300 megahertz to 450, that was an overclock.
But then you had the consideration of the heat load or the thermal watt dissipation, and then you're upgrading your cooling system or your cooling solution and then going from there.
But we're not really getting those kind of huge increases today. You're still getting decent overclocks, but like for me, I always brag about the old days where you got like a 50% increase in clock speed. So am I just being too much of an old timer there?
No. It's still relevant today.
Yeah. So you also did a lot of phase change stuff for your cooling?
I developed a lot of phase change technology, a lot of new design technology. Worked with Inventive and Aztec and OCZ for different phase change designs, single stage units. It proved not to be very viable solution because of the condensation issues and or the maintenance that's required. Taking the thing back apart every month was an issue for a lot of the people. Uh-huh. And then durability, or it's part of the meantime between failures was excellent because the refrigeration is like your home refrigerator. It can run forever and it can run at a consistent speed all the time. It was just the condensation issue became the major downfall of the platform.
Huh. What kind of temps could you hit with phase change back in your day?
The early stuff was 134A refrigerator, and it gets down to like 25, 35 below zero on a good day. Then we switched to R404 and the R507, which got us to 50 to 60 below zero. And then I developed a three-stage phased cascade cooler that got down to 110 below zero Celsius.
Do you think we could ever see a resurgence of phase change again, or is it just simply basically we're on liquid? Water or air, and that's the only answer for everybody?
I do have another phase change unit in design. I want to take a very large step, but I need to source more of my parts before I just start my build. But hopefully, most people would probably, consider condensing neon impossible or like something very hard to do. But if I do condense neon, that'll take me into the range of the 200 degrees Celsius below zero.
Wow. Okay, that's obviously for extreme overclocking.
Correct. I got to mix other gases with it to bring the head pressure down.
That's pretty cool. And then, of course, the advantage of that over liquid nitrogen that most people are liquid helium is.
Liquid helium is really hard to do, and especially it's impossible to get almost.
Oh, that's right.
And then But as far as the limitations, as far as, you know, needing an expansion tank as large as I need, and then having a expansion valve for the proper temperatures and pressures that I need for condensing the condensing the gas.
You know, actually, talking about the old days, I remember in the 300A days, the Pentium 2 days, actual overclocking of a CPU was frowned upon.
Correct.
By all the vendors, because they didn't want you to
destroy the hardware. They thought it was going to be easy to kill the hardware like instantly. But actually, it turned out to be actually quite a good solution, because I never killed a single CPU doing that.
But I think it's funny, because now, you know, we went from the days of them trying to actively prevent you from overclocking, to now it being like, it's really embraced, it's really like it's a feature.
Correct. And now all the big manufacturers have their own overclocking teams, ASUS, Gigabyte, and ASRock, and, you know, MSI. They all have their own in-house competitive overclocking teams that put up scores for their manufacturing group.
I just don't know how we went from, we want to stop you from doing it, to now we're marketing it.
I think they use it as a marketing tool. They want to be, you know, beyond high on the scoreboards, because like whenever we put, you know, whatever on the scoreboard, the people, you know, the consumers go look in on the scoreboards, they see what we're running, and that's what, you know, they base their buying decision on.
Right.
So if you have one of the top, you know, listings in the scoreboard, you have a good chance of marketing for that manufacturer.
True. It's just like a whatever car wins NASCAR you want to buy, or whatever sneakers your favorite player is wearing you want to wear.
Correct.
I guess I can see it.
And that also applies to the, you know, the overclocking scene too, because, you know, your favorite players, you want to run their hardware.
Yeah, even their pots and everything, and it's really cool, the whole competition thing. Do you think there's anything really left for regular people for overclocking these days, or have all the boost, turbo boost, and the has that taken over? There's really nothing left.
No, there's still more technology coming. There's a lot of stuff coming with AI technology, the integration of AI into the new processors. We're trying to get ahead of that and actually develop for the manufacturers to, you know, showcase those new features.
Okay. Any favorite stories? Because again, you've been doing this for 25 years, at least, I'm sure. What's your favorite story from all that time?
One of the top is meeting Gordon Moore. I did a lot of the touring with Intel Corporation, so I got to meet a lot of the Intel architects and designers, which was, you know, really, really good. But I pretty much like having my own events, you know, throwing my own events and having all of the industry come to my event, and having AMD and Intel Corporation at my event, and, you know, just really showing a really strong front, and, you know, being an independent, you know, at the time what I was doing, I was very, very strong in the industry.
Oh, no, it's cool, because again, it takes people being involved and showing that this is viable and that there's fun and it's a great hobby. It takes that to show the vendors that there's actually a future there. So
yeah,
I imagine, I mean, I'm not, you're not gonna say, but I'm gonna say, if it wasn't for a lot of the things you did helping to push that rock up the hill, we wouldn't be where we're at right now. So
thank you.
I think it's worth saying. And close it out. It's interesting to me, because like for most extreme overclocking competitions, 3DMark is always like one of the top tools they use. Why is 3DMark kind of like always there?
Well, 3DMark's the industry standard for benchmarks. I guess because of the validation and the validation tools that's involved with it. It's, you know, very available benchmark, and it's just, I guess, rose to the top, and it stayed there.
Cool. Well, thanks for talking to me. More fun videos from GDC 2023 on PC World channel. Click that like, subscribe, of course. Smash that bell button.
Thank you.